In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. His truth is marching on.
Hello, child of God. Before I begin explaining the manifestation of this next prophecy being fulfilled, I would like to take you back a few years in history to a time that the USA was deeply troubled and divided against itself. The early months of the American Civil War saw the assembly of both armies that consisted of thousands of young men that had never before been away from home. Both the Northern and Southern armies were said to be seduced by the influences of many sins. Among these many sins were drunkenness, gambling, and profanity. President Abraham Lincoln recognized the value of religion as a stabilizing force in the Union Army. And on May the 4th, 1861, he ordered all regimental commanders to appoint chaplains for their units. President Jefferson Davis and the Confederate government was more anxious to have fighting men than preaching men. But the Southern armies had some generals which had stronger religious convictions than all the governments. Particular to note are Generals Robert E. Lee and General T.J. or Stonewall Jackson, along with General Polk. Lee and Jackson did all within their power to encourage the spreading of the gospel in the Army of Northern Virginia. Jackson himself encouraged the troops to keep the Sabbath holy and attend worship services. Stonewall Jackson was frequently seen in prayer, both before and during the battles. He always acknowledged God as the author of his military victories. Union General George B. McClellan decreed that the North's war was a holy cause. He was nicknamed the Christian General and would himself preach to the troops when a regular chaplain or minister was not available. Union General William Rosecrans, a devout Catholic, made it a policy never to fight on Sundays. Revivals among the soldiers took place throughout the war, but it was during the late fall of 1863 and through the spring and summer of 1864 that the Great Revival occurred. The revival is best documented for Lee's Army of Northern Virginia, but it actually took place in both Northern and Southern armies, especially in the Virginia and Tennessee theaters of the war. American writer Julia Ward Howe, using the music of a camp meeting song, wrote the Battle Hymn of the Republic for members of the Union Army. It was first published in 1862. But it did not take long before soldiers of both the North and the South were singing the lyrics with great enthusiasm, as if the sacrifice of their own life in battle was a sacrifice for the Lord Jesus Christ. A great tragic irony is that both sides were having revival at their campfires and singing Christian hymns the night before the great battles. Christians from both sides were marching into battle and singing.
In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. His truth is marching on.
During the first 3 days of July in 1863, the two armies met to fight in the infamous Battle of Gettysburg. Between 46,000 and 51,000 soldiers from both sides were casualties of the three-day battle. The irony of both armies fighting for God was so notable that Abraham Lincoln addressed the issue several times. One of his statements was summarized and paraphrased over and over until it became very popular. The paraphrased version is that someone asked Abraham Lincoln, "Just whose side is God on?" The quote contributed to Abraham Lincoln is, "Sir, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side, for God is always right." On November the 19th, 1863, President Lincoln used the dedication ceremony for the Gettysburg National Cemetery to honor the fallen Union soldiers and redefine the purpose of the war in his historic Gettysburg Address. This concept continued to dominate Lincoln's public remarks for the rest of the war. The same theological allegory was to be prominent in Lincoln's second inaugural address in March 1865. Both North and South read the same Bible and pray to the same God, and each invokes his aid against the other. It may seem strange that any man should dare ask a just God's assistance in wringing their bread from the sweat of other men's faces. But let us judge not that we be not judged. The prayers of both could not be answered. That of neither has been answered fully. The Almighty has his own purposes. These Civil War time revivals continued even when Sherman's troops marched across and burned Georgia down through to the Carolinas. When the soldiers stopped for a fight, they frequently assembled in local churches and worshiped. Let's try to keep in mind this wartime irony as I discuss the next prophecy. If I were to tell you that God is on Israel's side, I could expect an army of Christians to march into battle against this message. Democrats, Republicans, Tories, Independents, and every flavor of left-wing, right-wing, and centralist Christians of every nation. However, all of you are most welcome to make comments below and discuss it. Almighty God is always right, and what he is doing in Israel today is always right. Israel is an extremely secular and sinful nation with legalized abortions, homosexual marriages, homosexual beaches, and a very high drug and crime rate. Many of the Orthodox Jews in Israel hate everything that is not Orthodox Judaism, especially the Lord Jesus Christ and Christians. They will soon embrace and accept a false Messiah, an Antichrist. When the Lord Jesus Christ returns, he's coming with an army. Why? The Lord Jesus Christ himself is returning to destroy the wicked of all nations from this planet and then rule this planet in peace for 1,000 years. Is God on Israel's side? That's an absolute yes. Almighty God's word and promises to Israel will be fulfilled in God's own timing. We can each have our wonderful time in revival, and then we can each march down the hill for or against Israel and fire our religious guns at each other. Or we can come to terms with our intellectual arrogance and ask ourselves, just what is Almighty God doing? I want to be on God's side in these matters, regardless of popular religious opinion. Can we each be on God's side when he destroys Israel? Can we each be on God's side when he destroys our own homes? Can we be on God's side when the economy falls and there's no electrical power, gas, or water available? When famine, the disease, and war, and poverty reach each one of us? And then death. If you examine the prophecies, you will see that soon, Daniel's 70th week, a time of judgment is coming upon the nation of Israel and the whole world. Roughly 2,000 years ago, the Apostle Peter preached a sermon on the day of Pentecost, saying that the prophecy of Joel 2:28 had been fulfilled.
And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids, in those days will I pour out my Spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and the terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call.
There have been several prophets listed in the New Testament, plus those Christians manifesting the gifts of prophecy. Almighty God is an intentionally invisible God, and occasionally he speaks to man through his prophets. He has spoken through a donkey, through thunder, through angels and men. And in these last days, he's sending so many signs and wonders and fulfilled prophecies that there is no excuse for mankind to ignore his warnings. And just as the Lord Jesus Christ appeared to Saul on the way to Damascus, we hear testimonies of the Lord Jesus Christ himself manifesting before Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim, and other religious leaders. A personal evangelism by the Lord Jesus Christ. This manifestation creates a dynamic change in that leader, and usually Christian revivals in those religions follow. One of these religious leaders that had a Jesus moment was the highly respected Orthodox Jewish rabbi Kadori. There's been an explosion of videos on YouTube about Kadori seeing the Messiah and the prophecy about the return of the Messiah after the death of Ariel Sharon. If you just search YouTube for the words Ariel Sharon prophecy, there will be over 30,000 results. Before his death, Kadori said that he expected the Jewish Messiah to arrive soon and that he had met him a year earlier. Before he died at 108 years old, he left a handwritten note to his followers. They were instructed to only open the note after Rabbi Kadori had been dead for 1 year. After the time period was passed, the note was opened by his followers and was translated as, "He will raise the people and confirm that his word and law are standing," which by acronym suggests the name Yeshua, a Hebrew version of Joshua or Jesus. Well, we all know that the mark of a true prophet is that all his prophecies have been fulfilled. And we know by default, Ariel Sharon has died and the Messiah will be revealed to Israel soon. The prophecy could have easily been an educated guess. That will be fulfilled. However, unless you and I discuss a much earlier prophecy of Rabbi Kadori, this Orthodox Jewish rabbi, Rabbi Kadori, was famous for fulfilled prophecies, for healing in his ministry, for knowledge of the Word of God, for his wisdom, knowledge, and understanding in the Scriptures. He has many followers in Israel and around the world in his Orthodox sect. On September the 24th, 2001, he made a prophecy that the Gog and Magog war would commence on the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles and last for 7 years. Well, just a few days later, on the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles, October 7, 2001, the USA began attacking the Al-Qaeda terrorist. Well, a lot of the Orthodox Jews jumped to the conclusion that this was it. This was the Gog and Magog War. So they kind of took the issue and made it fit the prophecy, which is 12 plus years later, the U.S. is still fighting the war with Al-Qaeda, so that was obviously not correct. We either see that he was wrong in his prophecy, or they were wrong to jump to conclusions that this was the manifestation of the prophecy. But there's more unusual information about this. Let's forget that Al-Qaeda and look at this last day of the Feast of Tabernacles for 2014. That's October 15, 2014. That's just around the corner. Well, take a look at this. The first blood red moon is right around the corner, April the 15th, 2014. The next one is on the Feast of Tabernacles, which is October the 8th, 2014. And the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles could begin the Gog and Magog War, according to his prophecy. Now, I'm not trying to make the facts fit the prophecy. It's the other way around. If you look at the prophecy and you look at the facts are that Israel is about to attack. They've committed to attack Iran's nuclear weapons program. They've got to do it. It's self-defense. If they wait until the Feast of Tabernacles to do it, I'd be totally shocked, but they just might. And on the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles, the Gog and Magog war begins. It means that Russia will be involved. So at any time between now and then, Israel could attack Iran's nuclear weapons program. Iran retaliates. The whole Middle East goes into crisis. Until Russia comes in as leadership, that's Gog and Magog, and takes those nations that are listed in Ezekiel 38 and 39 and makes their attack on Israel. If the prophecy's not manifested on the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles in 2014, then the Gog and Magog war could begin on the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles of 2015, which is also right after a blood red moon. The blood red moon of 2015 is on the Feast of Tabernacles, beginning of the Feast of Tabernacles. 7 days later, bam, there is the Gog and Magog war. Now, the blood red moons mean bad news for Israel. The four of them together, bang, 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 bang. It's always bad news for Israel. Remember the verses in Joel that were read. The moon will be red as blood and the sun black as sackcloth. We have solar eclipse, we have lunar eclipses, and so on. Now, at the end of the Gog and Magog war, the Lord sends an earthquake and shakes the entire planet and shakes the mountains to the ground and the buildings fall down and all these things happen. Fire on Russia, destruction in the Middle East, and so on. But at the end of that war, Israel has 7 years of peace. And those 7 years of peace, they rebuild the temple that Ezekiel saw in Ezekiel's chapter 41 through 48. And the sacrifices begin again. And the Holy Spirit comes in and takes residence in the temple and so on. But during this 7 years, it will actually be Daniel's 70th week. This will be a manifestation of the prophecy of Daniel. It looks like this is the time when the actual Antichrist will arise in Europe, and he will take his position and do the 10 horns and the 3 horns and the 1 horn and so on. All these things are manifested, plus the 200 million Chinese soldiers will be coming down. So at the end of this thing will be the Battle of Armageddon, the return of the Lord Jesus Christ in power with his angels, and quite possibly the celebrate the first Jubilee year in several thousand years. Okay, speculation, and I would not dare give you a date on when the Lord Jesus Christ is coming. However, please put your comments on the bottom of this page and let's discuss it. These are the end times, no matter how you look at it. If you're on God's side, you're agreeing with what God is doing.
Then said he unto them, Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And great earthquakes shall be in divers places, and famines, and pestilences, and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations, with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he spake to them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees. When they now shoot forth, ye see and know of your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting, and drunkenness, and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man.
The instructions the Lord Jesus Christ gave us is that we should pray that we are able to stand before the Son of Man. My friend, no one is able to stand before the Son of Man unless he is washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. There are none righteous, no, not one. We have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Let us pray now together and ask Almighty God to forgive our sin and wash us in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just follow after me in prayer, but pray with your own faith and your own sincerity. Father God, that's right, just pray in faith after me. Father God, I ask you now to forgive all of my sin and wash me in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and make me holy unto you. Baptize me now in the Holy Spirit and give me more power to resist temptations. I acknowledge that the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay for my sin and is soon to return. I forgive all of those people that I have resented or hated, and I receive from you the free gift of salvation. I dedicate my life and commit my spirit to you. I ask you now to keep me strong in the time of testing and help me to stand before the Son of Man. I receive that as done. Amen.
Thank you for praying with me, child of God. If you'd like to see more videos on the baptism of the Holy Spirit or on end-time prophecy, please click the links at the end of the arrows. May God bless you. Peace be unto your house.